Hello and welcome to PNP Live. I'm Alan Watke, an event coordinator with Politics and Prose. Thank you for joining us in this new format where we continue to bring you the authors you love and their new books to the Politics and Prose community. At any time during the event, you can click on the green button below to purchase Unholy at Politics and Prose's website. Our physical stores are still closed, and we do need your online purchases in order to keep bringing you the programming the PNP is known for. Another way to support Politics and Prose tonight is by using the donate button below at the bottom, and you can contribute whatever you are able to. Tonight, you can ask Sarah a question by clicking on Ask a Question, which can be found near the bottom of your screen as well. You can also read other people's questions and even vote for the ones you'd like to hear the most. Finally, we want to thank you all for being here with us tonight. We're so thankful to our family of loyal customers helping our business and our spirit stay afloat. Tonight, I'm very pleased to welcome Sarah Posner to PNP Live for her new book, Unholy: Why White Evangelicals Worship at the Altar of Donald Trump. Sarah is a reporting fellow with Type Investigations and the author of God's Prophets: Faith, Fraud, and the Republican Crusade for Values Voters. For more than a decade, she has covered the intersection of politics and religion, and more recently has covered the rise of the alt-right in the Trump era. Her work has appeared in the Washington Post, the New York Times, Rolling Stone, Mother Jones, The Nation, and many other publications. Sarah will be joined in conversation tonight with Jeff Sharlet, an associate professor of English and creative writing at Dartmouth and the best-selling author of The Family, made into a Netflix documentary series, and This Brilliant Darkness, C Street, and Sweet Heaven When I Die. His work has earned numerous awards, including the National Magazine Award and the Outspoken Award. And so without further ado, please welcome to PNP Live, Sarah Posner and Jeff Sharlet.
Thanks, Alan. Thank you so much for hosting this. And thank you everyone who's joining us tonight online. I wish I could see some of you in person, but it's also nice to have people who are not in Washington able to watch and join us tonight. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the book and about the book coming to us or coming out in the world during this extraordinary situation and these extraordinary circumstances and times that we're living in. I always knew, because this is the Trump presidency after all, that when the book came out, there would most likely be something chaotic going on. But I never in my wildest imagination would have expected that to be a global pandemic and nationwide protests over another pandemic of police brutality against Black citizens. People often ask me, how can the Christian right, or how can people who call themselves Christians support Trump, who is a liar and a racist and an admitted pussy grabber and corrupt and all of his terrible tweets insulting people? And I get that question all the time, but it's not really the right question about why the Christian right supports Donald Trump. They don't support him in spite of these things, and they don't support him solely because of a transactional relationship that they have with him, where he has promised them and fulfilled promises to them of appointing judges and political appointees within agencies, both cabinet secretaries and lower level political appointees who will carry out their agenda. That's part of it. And certainly that's an important factor in why they continue to support him. But it's much bigger than that. Their support for him is about his being a strong man. It's about his being an authoritarian. They like to call him a disruptor or God's chaos candidate. And they like the idea that he is upending what they consider to be political correctness or the liberal media, or in the case of what's happening right now in the streets of America, extremists or Antifa activists who they believe are the ones who are causing trouble in the streets of America, very similarly to the reaction to Charlottesville. So when you saw the Christian right not back away from Trump after Charlottesville, it's very similar motivations why they're backing him now. And so as you're seeing these protests across America, where Black people are basically being asked not to be brutalized by the police, the important thing that the Christian right is focusing on, or the issue that they've made front and center, is their complaints that governors and localities' stay-at-home or safer-at-home orders are discriminating against churches because churches have not been allowed to meet without restrictions or in large numbers. And they are looking at Trump as the champion of their religious freedom because he has overrode CDC recommendations about distancing and being together and singing and praying together or just being together in large gatherings during the pandemic. And to them, to the Christian right, Trump is their hero, even as he's calling on governors to dominate protesters on the street. His Christian right supporters are overlooking that and looking instead at how they believe they are being victimized by stay-at-home orders because they can't meet at church, but Trump is their champion because he's calling for the churches to be reopened. And so this is not just about a transaction, and it's not about religion, or it's not about whether Trump is a good Christian or adheres to the teachings of Jesus. It's really about a political ideology that has been decades in the making, and that Trump is their savior, Trump is their hero. And it's not in spite of his shortcomings, it's because of it, or what other people might see as his shortcomings. So if you're reading Unholy sort of expecting to find out, you know, some sort of checklist of like, oh, have they forgiven him about Stormy Daniels, or have they overlooked what happened in the impeachment proceedings? And it's really much more profound than that, because they're living in another manufactured reality where they believe that Trump is a victim of the media, of the Democratic Party, of liberals, of political correctness, and they're bound together with him so that together they can save America from those forces. So I'll send it over to Jeff now, so he can, I know he has a lot of questions, and then we can open it up to the audience for more questions.
Oh, thank you, Sarah. I do have a lot of questions because I just want so much of what's in this book to get out there in the world right now. Clearly a book like this is gonna be important leading up to the 2020 election, and it feels even more important in this crisis. I think it is, I think it's the most important political book I've read since Nancy McLean's Democracy in Chains. And as much as I've been sort of trying to understand Trump all these years, this book was just page after page opening my eyes. But maybe let me just start by asking you about one of the theses right there in the beginning. And I think you sort of alluded to it, that the love for Trump is not this, it's not about the what of Trump so much as the how, and it's not despite being a strong man, it's because he's a strong man. That strong man is, that the method is the message that white evangelicals have been looking for. What does that mean? What does that mean that they've been looking for a strong man?
Well, they believe that over the course of the second half of the 20th century, social changes and political changes and legal changes in America came at the expense of their rights and their way of life. And this is the way in which they sort of intersect with the alt-right and white nationalists, because maybe not in precisely the same ways, those grievances are very similar in the sense that they believe that, say, the civil rights movement have taken away their rights. And so Trump, whereas Republican presidential candidates in recent memory have appealed to the Christian right by discussing their piety or talking about the Bible. You think about George W. Bush, you know, telling his salvation story, invoking the Bible, talking about spirituality, talking about Jesus. And while the Christian right liked that, and for a long time they demanded that of presidential candidates, but with Trump, they dispensed with that. They didn't really care that he couldn't talk about the Bible and that he really evinced no knowledge of what was inside the Bible, even in the sort of superficial, in any kind of superficial or proof texting kind of way even. And so what they liked about him was that he didn't worry about appealing to or appeasing anyone who disagreed with them, right? Whereas previous Republicans, they thought about like, oh, how am I gonna win over the independents? Or how am I gonna win over the moderates? Or are we too focused on the social issues? Should we talk about other issues or creating a bigger tent for the Republican Party, which was something that Republican activists and operatives talked about after Obama won. Trump didn't bother with any of those niceties. He doesn't care about bipartisanship. He cares about domination and he cares about winning and he cares about insulting people. And when he's, because he's on their side on every issue that he's attacking his enemies on, and he's willing to attack the enemies that they perceive as having taken away their rights or their, or the roots or the foundation of Christian America, then he becomes more of a hero than, you know, say George W. Bush or Ronald Reagan, who were much, you know, much more interested in gauzy talk about, you know, America, the shining city on the hill. Trump talks about American carnage, right? So this is what drew evangelical voters to him first, and ultimately a lot of the leadership of the religious right.
It's, you know, you talk about him becoming a hero, and but then I'm struck by thinking about some of the connections you make in the book between Trump's study of religious broadcasting, mm-hmm. and that kind of natural affinity with Paula White, who is now in the Trump administration, right, having been investigated by Republicans, by Senator Chuck Grassley not that long ago.
Right.
And, you know, for kind of hucksterism. But it occurs to me, thinking about some of the historical connections that you make, he's not so much a hero as an anti-hero. And I think we've all sort of worked at the reality television connections, but also look, Trump comes after decades of Sopranos and The Shield and so on, where in the American narrative, we're accustomed to an anti-hero. And I'm thinking in particular about that crucial section in the middle of the book, this deep history that you're writing. And you're going through the papers of William Rusher, the publisher of the National Review, and this kind of prophecy of a third party candidate, and the idea that he's saying, and boy, is this relevant today? I mean, literally today, this mm-hmm. Monday, June 1, mm-hmm. That the prototype of George Wallace would be the future of the Republican politics, not so much a hero, an anti-hero, someone who was good at insulting, someone who was good at fighting. They weren't looking for sweet. They were looking for fists. Tell us more about William Rusher and the longing for someone to hit, someone who'll do hitting.
So Rusher was, as you said, the publisher of the National Review. And while William Buckley is more well known or more of a household name, because as editor of the National Review, he was just kind of more the public face of the magazine. But Rusher was a very influential figure in what was at the time known as the New Right. This is in the 70s and 80s. And was very much as Peter Brimelow, who's now a leading figure in the alt-right, an anti-immigration activist who runs the white nationalist website VDare. Brimelow has called Rusher a nursemaid for the conservative movement because he kind of cultivated these figures that you might not hear that much about today, but they were sort of the forerunners of the alt-right, or they are now the alt-right, but they were kicking around Washington in the 70s and 80s, and Rusher was helping to jumpstart their careers. So Brimelow was one of the people that Rusher helped. And so Rusher believed that there needed to be some kind of revolution within conservatism that defended white people. And he was not that explicit, but defended white people against these incursions of the civil rights movement and other social change that was taking place at that time. And so he cultivated people like Brimelow, and you were talking about Nancy McLean's Democracy in Chains. And another figure that he cultivated was Robert Whitaker, who was basically like a mid-level functionary in Washington in the 1970s, but he had studied with James Buchanan, who's the figure at the center of Democracy in Chains, who's the economist. He's the economist who developed the public choice theory. And Rusher helped promote Whitaker's career. Now, Whitaker was an open white supremacist back then. Rusher helped him publish a book called The Plague on Both Your Houses, where he basically blames both the Republican and the Democratic Party for the condition that, you know, white America finds itself in. And he was basically calling for a third party who would be unafraid to, you know, unafraid like the Republicans of basically telling it like it is, right? Like basically what Trump ended up doing decades later. And Whitaker later, many years later, resurfaced as the author of what's known in white supremacist circles as the mantra, which is the argument in which he argues that diversity is white genocide, and that if you're anti-racist, that means you're anti-white. And so Whitaker ultimately ended up being this, he died in 2017, but he ultimately ended up being this very heroic figure for white supremacists and the alt-right. But back in the 70s and 80s, he was kicking around Washington, hobnobbing with William Rusher and working in the Reagan administration in the Office of Management and Budget. So these kinds of ideas have been kicking around the conservative movement long before Trump came along, laying this groundwork essentially for a conservative movement that would be comfortable with Trump and glad to have someone who wasn't going to bend to political correctness and just say what white people have wanted a politician to say.
That's what I find so vital and crucial about this book. And I think about this in terms of this question that so many liberals and leftists want to answer for themselves. And they say, you know, is Trump an aberration or is he not? And some leftists say, no, he's not. This is what the Republican Party always was. That's not quite true. There was a concerted effort, you show, to make it into this. I mean, even from William Rusher, much less known than William F. Buckley. Mm-hmm. This isn't Buckley's party now, as nasty as that was.
Right.
This is Rusher's. Mm-hmm. This is Rusher's party, and figures like Brimelow. And in fact, you tell me that you're right that there's something called the Brimelow thesis. And what I love too is also you've done the reporting. You've not only identified all these figures who kind of escape scrutiny, you've gone out and somehow managed to get them to talk to you, from Brimwo to the nastiest of the nasties, Richard Spencer. But Brimwo tells you about the Brimwo thesis, about all these sort of far right guys scattered through Washington, and some of them white supremacists, and then some of them these sort of peculiar figure. I mean, to the extent Stephen Miller, who's Jewish, or tell us maybe about. I'm really curious if you could explain more about what, because people always want to know what is Trump actually doing for the religious right. I think what Roger Severino, a Trump appointee, is doing is such an excellent example.
Mm-hmm. So, right. So the Brimelow thesis is that all around Washington, there are people in the alt-right working in what Brimelow told me was the government industry, right? And he should know, you know, he doesn't work in Washington anymore, but he told me a lot of his writers for VDare work in Washington, and he once worked for Senator Orrin Hatch. So he's, you know, familiar with the way Washington works. And he told me, this was before Trump got elected, that people in the alt-right are all around Washington, well, probably a lot more now, right? And that they like to be kind of under the radar because they don't want to be outed and banished or exiled like Brimelow was from the National Review. So when Brimelow wrote for the National Review for a long time, and Buckley exiled him, and Brimelow and his allies retain this resentment about what they call conservatism, Inc., where they, conservatism, Inc. was the conservatism that's nervous about having white supremacists, you know, write white papers for think tanks or write articles for their leading magazines, and they banish them from polite company. With Trump, there's less of that happening. Now, the religious right has always been extremely open about wanting power in Republican administrations. And certainly George W. Bush gave them a lot of power too in running agencies and so forth. But Roger Severino, who is the director of the Office of Civil Rights at the Department of Health and Human Services, has used that kind of power perhaps more than any other religious right ideologue that Trump has nominated or appointed to any federal agency, with the exception probably of Jeff Sessions and Bill Barr. Severino took the Office of Civil Rights, which is basically an office inside this sprawling federal bureaucracy designed to protect the Department of Health and Human Services serves Americans all over the country with, you know, health care and you know, social services of many different kinds. And the Office of Civil Rights is intended to ensure that people's, you know, civil rights aren't violated in the provision of those kinds of services. Well, Severino takes control of that office, and one of the first things he does is create a conscience and religious liberty division within the Office of Civil Rights, which becomes like his pet project to give Christians, who they would say they would give any religious, anybody with any religious objection, but it's obviously intended for Christians who have objections to, say, abortion or LGBT rights, the right to file a complaint with the Office of Civil Rights and have the Office of Civil Rights investigate it and possibly, you know, punish a state or a hospital for violating the religious objectors' civil rights. And this is like a pretty extraordinary power that he has exercised in establishing this. But this is one of the many things, but a very important thing, that Trump has done or allowed a political appointee to do that has earned him the title of the most pro-life and the most pro-religious liberty president ever from the Christian right.
And that term, religious liberty, and listeners, if they're sitting there saying, well, I'm all for religious liberty too, absolutely. But of course, some of us sort of know that the Christian right uses that. It's not even a euphemism. Religious liberty is only for true religions. So of course that doesn't extend to Islam, which is satanic, and Buddhism and all these kinds of things, depending on the religious right figure. Sometimes they'll allow that. But you've got the receipts. You went to, what is it, 114 briefs that you went through of the ADF, what is it, the Alliance for Defending Freedom?
Alliance Defending Freedom.
Freedom, right. And they say, we're just about religious liberty, but in 114 briefs, they really kind of forgot to pick up any issue but Christianity. and I just thought, and that kind of reporting is also what makes this book sort of just astonishing, the legwork you've done for this, of just going out and finding out what's happening. And one of the things I find most compelling, you mentioned Jeff Sessions. You start the book with one of your scoops, a scoop I remember when you had the scoop of getting, when Trump first came in, that draft of this executive order for religious freedom. Now, that draft didn't end up getting passed as it was, right? Mm-hmm. But you then go say, okay, that didn't get passed, but what actually happened? And you talk about how Jeff Sessions, through this guidance for the Department of Justice, was in a way able to implement everything and this kind of baldly theocratic executive order that was deemed too extreme at the moment to pass, well, it just got done under the radar. Tell us how that happened.
So this draft was circulating within a week or two of Trump taking office. It was a draft executive order, which was basically, when I saw it, and I had been reporting on what the religious right was aiming for in terms of like religious exemptions and allowing religious objectors to turn away customers or turn away clients or, think of Kim Davis in Kentucky, the court clerk who had a religious objection to giving marriage licenses to same-sex couples, to basically like operationalize that everywhere in any walk of life. I mean, the way the draft executive order was written, it would have permitted, an accountant to turn away a lesbian couple from, preparing their tax return. I mean, it was just incredibly broad. When I got the draft order in my hands and I showed it to constitutional experts, they were aghast. They were like, this is just so out of control and overbroad and unconstitutional. And in probably one of the first incidents of this type in Trump's presidency, he decides not to sign this draft executive order. And there are leaks to the media that Jared and Ivanka had counseled him that like maybe he didn't want to go full anti-LGBTQ like this. Mm-hmm. So like, so they get the credit for drawing him back from being anti-gay. But then a few months later, he signs another executive order that basically orders Jeff Sessions to create guidance about religious freedom within federal agencies. So they're not able to go full bore and tell, an accountant in Indiana that he can turn away a gay couple from his, from his business. But they do go full bore in basically saying to the federal government that these kinds of religious objections should be honored within federal agencies, by contractors, by grantees of the federal government. So think about, religious contractors that provide services to children or, adoption, foster care, child detention, and other, other types of, mental health services, drug treatment services. And so the aim was to have it come from DOJ for the other agencies to basically create the rules to allow those kinds of religious objections.
Hmm. This kind of theocratic vision, though, what I find so so compelling, and I want to ask you about some of those theological parallels too. But when we look at this way, that here's Trump, and he sort of says, he gets sort of credit, right? Jared and Ivanka talked him out of that. And meanwhile, the work still gets done.
Right.
Sort of in some ways illustrating just a thesis of this book, which is, don't let the man on top distract you from what's going down and going on in these lower levels. In the same way that you say, don't let the religious right's own claims about abortion as its central mission distract you from the racist roots. And I think a lot of us were familiar with the idea that, of course, some of this struggle had to do with the federal government and desegregation. But you unearth a whole cast of characters and give us these stories. And in particular, I'm wondering if you could maybe tell us the story of Bob Billings and the racist roots of the modern Christian right, and how that starts to help us see how the Christian right and the white nationalist alt-right are not uneasy bedfellows. They were made for each other. They were always headed toward each other.
So, you know, it's been reported before, I think most prominently by Randy Balmer, that Paul Weyrich, who was an early organizer of the New Right and of the religious right, who's a pretty central character in my book. Randy reported years ago that Weyrich told him that when he tried, Weyrich was Catholic, but he tried to get evangelicals on board in creating the religious right, creating the moral majority with Jerry Falwell. And Weyrich told Randy in the 70s that, you know, that he could not get evangelicals interested in the abortion issue like Catholics were, and that the issue that really motivated the evangelicals to get involved in national political politics was the IRS rules on desegregating private schools, including private Christian schools. And you know, that has been out there, right, for a number of years, thanks to Randy. And, but I wanted to know more about that. Like, I felt like the story was not fully told. And so I dove into historical archives, digitized newspaper archives, and basically, you know, found out that this guy, Bob Billings, who was an independent fundamentalist Baptist preacher, was like one of the leading figures in promoting private Christian schools, K-12 Christian schools in the 1960s and 70s. I mean, he traveled the country helping different communities set up these schools. Now, at the same time, there were schools that were being established that were known as segregation academies. These were established explicitly because they were in communities where white people did not want their kids going to desegregated schools in the wake of, you know, Brown v. Board of Education. But at the same time, these Christian schools were being set up ostensibly because the Supreme Court had ruled mandatory prayer and Bible reading in the early 1960s, ruled that unconstitutional. But as it turned out, the IRS was shutting down, taking away the tax exemption of the explicitly segregation academies. But to these other schools that were essentially pretty much all white, but not explicitly segregation academies, the IRS was coming to them and saying, look, here's the deal. You need to make these kinds of efforts to not be all white, right? So you have to, like, if you have like a certain percentage of Black students in your community, in your school, you're good. But if you don't, we'll let you show us some other ways that you're trying to desegregate, like going out in the community and recruiting students, having your students play, you know, inter-school sports, interscholastic sports with other, you know, with in the broader community, trying to hire teachers of color, that sort of thing. These rules were incredibly minimal, right? I mean, like, they were not particularly difficult to comply with, but there was a very big movement, and this is the thing that motivated these evangelicals. They claimed that the government was trying to impose quotas on them and violate their religious freedom. And this is what activated them and animated them into the religious right with Weyrich. Weyrich thought that Billings, you know, when I looked at Weyrich's papers, it was pretty clear that he thought that Billings was like a much better guy to go with than Falwell, because like Billings like really like got, you know, was getting this organizing going. And so they used the Bob Jones University was the segregationist college in South Carolina that did lose its tax exempt status. And even today, evangelicals still talk about that case as where the government, the IRS took away their tax exempt status. And still today that case is talked about as like this great infringement of religious freedom and a sign that the government would use its, idea of promoting social policy to infringe on the rights of Christians or the religious freedom rights of Christians or Christian institutions.
One of the things I admire most about this book is just the art, the way that you take us, you take us back into this history, introduce us to these absolutely essential but overlooked figures. And if that's all the book did, that would be enough. But then you sort of bring this always sort of back to the present. And I'm wondering if you can do that through, you've got a chapter, I think it's called The End of American Exceptionalism. And it's the way in which this kind of racist evangelicalism is meeting with sort of white power to end with a certain kind of nationalism until we get to the sort of pro-Russian stance. Mm-hmm. And that long precedes Trump. I think a lot of people sort of think that Trump invented that. Alan Carlson, the World Congress of Families, and this kind of eugenicist movement. And I just have to ask you to say a word about, I almost feel this is like a dirty thing to say out loud, a right-wing outfit called the Repository for Germinal Choice. If you could tell us, or also known as, by them, as the Nobel Sperm Bank. Tell us about how these kinds of evangelicalism and this kind of white power lead us to this strange moment where leaders like Viktor Orban, beyond Putin, somehow are more important than even American nationalism. It's white nationalism that matters now.
Wow, that was a question with a lot of moving parts. my starting point with that chapter is how for so many years, since Reagan, obviously the Shining City on the Hill theme dates back obviously before Reagan, but Reagan really promoted it, right? And that that America is like a beacon to the rest of the world, that America is about freedom, and that that we shine out as a light to the rest of the world because of our promotion and adherence to freedom. But after Obama was president, conservatives did not think that that was true anymore. Like Obama had ruined that, right? And so they started, and Weyrich even started looking towards Russia, just after the fall of communism, right? Because he thought that right wingers in Russia who might want to have a Russia that restored Orthodox Christianity at the center of a nationalist ideology would be kind of a model for the United States. But for the broader, that did not really take hold. Like Weyrich talked about that a lot back in the late 80s, 90s, but that did not really take hold very much until later among the rank and file of the Christian right, until Trump. So what you see over the course of, probably Obama's presidency, and it coincides with the rise of this right-wing ethno-nationalist autocracies, in Russia, you mentioned Viktor Orban, and in some other places, you see the rise of these parties in Germany, the Alternative for Germany, and the Freedom Party in Austria. So all of this is going on together. But you have activists on the Christian right looking towards Russia and Orban as better examples of Christian nationalism because they're willing to beat back what they call gender ideology. And gender ideology is their word for LGBT rights. And so they believe that that has all gone too far. Reproductive rights and LGBTQ rights around the world they argue is ruining the family, ruining the concept of the family. And because in the United States, we've allowed all of this to happen, we've allowed same-sex marriage and abortion is still legal for a while, we should really be looking eastward towards someone like Putin or Orban, who very deliberately tout the Christian roots of their country and have pushed back on this gender ideology. And so when you have organizations like the World Congress of Families, like that's an organization that promotes that kind of idea that American exceptionalism has fallen away because of liberalism and that we should look to these other leaders. And so this helps explain, you know, part of the appeal of Trump, because he looks more like Putin than, or Orban, than Obama.
And I'll just start taking some questions from the audience. And although I have many, many more questions, and fortunately I see someone asking one of the questions I wanted to ask. So I'll credit to, well, they don't have their name attached to it, but they ask, how widespread are analogies of Trump to Cyrus among white evangelicals? Are they viewing history recursively, like they're living through biblical history right now? And tell us about Cyrus. There's Putin, there's Orban, and then there's King Cyrus. Tell us what that is.
So Cyrus in the Bible was a Persian king who helped the Jews rebuild Jerusalem, right? And so in that analogy, and it's a very common analogy that particularly in like Pentecostal and charismatic circles of the Christian right, it's a very common analogy for Trump. And the analogy is, we don't, you know, so Cyrus wasn't Jewish, but he helped, you know, helped the Jews go back, you know, return to Jerusalem from exile and rebuild the holy city. And so the analogy is that Trump may not really be a Christian, or maybe he's a baby Christian, but he is helping us rebuild Christian America. Yeah. That's the short version. And so, you know, but I see we have other questions, so.
Well, let's see, we have a lot of questions of the what is to be done variety.
Yeah.
So let's see, Amanda says, Sarah, are you seeing any indication that mainline Christian denominations are doing anything to retake this ground, or are they ceding it? And are there concrete steps they should, that's in quotation marks, but they should be taking to turn the tide back?
I don't think that it's the sort of thing where mainline denominations can turn the tide back. I mean, I think that there are, you do see figures like, you know, William Barber comes to mind, right? So like other Christian leaders involved in politics who have a different vision of Christianity and a different vision of politics.
Reverend William Barber of the Moral Mondays movement,
right,
in Carolina for poor folks.
So, but I don't think that it's like, I don't think that the goal would be to retake this ground or anything like that, right? I don't know how productive that is, right? I mean, I think that the Christian right and a lot of the evangelical and Pentecostal and charismatic churches that I see and have been to, and you know, you see this on social media and in their own media bubble as well. I mean, they're living in kind of an alternative reality. Like today, this morning, I watched a video that was done yesterday by Evangelicals for Trump, which is the coalition arm of his reelection campaign, where they're motivating evangelicals to go out and vote for him. And it was Mercedes Schlapp, who, you know, works for his campaign, Paula White, who we've talked about, Alveda King, who's an anti-abortion activist and the niece of Martin Luther King Jr., and Sissy Graham Lynch, the granddaughter of Billy Graham. And it was just the four of them on a Zoom call. And you would have, if you didn't know, if you had just been dropped in from outer space, you would have thought that Donald Trump did a fantastic job with the pandemic. that he's been this incredibly strong, decisive, effective leader, that Democrats are the real racists, and that Nancy Pelosi, her goal was to get money in this, in the COVID relief packages to Planned Parenthood so it could carry out a genocide. So, you know, like retaking that ground is like, you know, it's a difficult thing, right? I mean, like, how do you retake that religious ground, right? Like, how do you, you know, you can do your thing and hope that people listen to you and see your vision and, you know, rethink where they are. I guess that's the goal of some, you know, some liberal religious leaders, liberal Christian leaders. But I think the main thing is that people have to get out and vote. I mean, because the religious right has a very big role in the Republican Party. And so because they play such a big role in getting Republicans elected and play such a big role in getting Donald Trump elected, they're rewarded with, you know, a lot of power in his administration, and they're not going to give that up very easily.
They are not going to give that up very easily and get out and vote, which maybe brings us to Mark Gruber Leibowitz's question. As suppose we all get out and vote. Mark is concerned. He says, do you think it is likely that Trump's far right evangelical followers will rise up, possibly in violent ways, if Biden defeats Trump in November? And in other words, there's the what is to be done question, and then there's the how far gone are we question.
Well, I think for the religious right, I think that they would be more likely to back Trump in, you know, charges that the election was rigged, or that there was voter fraud or something of that nature. They have a very robust media infrastructure where they're able to get a lot of those kinds of conspiracy theories and memes out to their listeners and their viewers, both on television, radio, social media. I think they would be more likely to do that. But as we've seen in the past few weeks with these protests against the stay-at-home orders first, and then second, some of these racists who've showed up at protests over George Floyd's murder, you know, there is definitely a contingent that could be violent. I don't think it's the religious right that would be that contingent.
Yeah, Sarah, you write in the book about the long predicted and worked for conservative populist alliance. And in some ways we see it now, right? That it's Trump and McConnell. In that conservative branch, and maybe in that elite branch, I see two questions that are close to my heart, and particularly because you're more up to date than I am. And so tell me what's going on here. Stephen says, please discuss the National Prayer Breakfast and the people that host it. Trump used their latest event in February as a campaign rally. And Matthew P. Henry writes, for example, is there any truth to this being part of the family as a method to gain power, not only in the US, but around the world? And so what does that elite strand have to do with this convergence you're describing?
Well, you obviously know more about the family than I do. Way more about the family.
Historically, but you're out there on the ground now. I want to tell us what's happening now. Not with the family, but with, in some ways, I think that the question there, and Stephen and Matthew, if I can consolidate these questions a little bit, is also in the book a little bit the Russell Moore question, mm-hmm. About an old evangelical, not so old, but an evangelical elite that's been displaced.
Well, I think that Trump has been enabled by elite actors in Washington. You know, the entire Senate Republican caucus, right? I mean, they've, apart from Mitt Romney, who voted on one count of impeachment against him, they've all conceded or submitted to his authority, basically. But Trump's power, I feel like, or his popularity does really come from a cultivated populist impulse, right? I mean, like, we know from the book that, you know, someone like William Rusher for a long time was aiming for some kind of populist uprising within the Republican Party, whereby you'd have this third party, essentially, which Trump essentially is, but he's taken over the Republican Party. So it's not really a third party, but he fulfills that kind of vision. And so I don't know. I mean, I think that does, you know, someone like Mitch McConnell like Trump? I think probably not, but has Trump been good for McConnell and McConnell's political goals? Yes. And so I think it has more to do with, you know, one of the questioners had a question about like America's role around the world, but I really think that it has more to do with political power here in the United States and cementing that through, you know, primarily judicial appointments, but also just, you know, things like, you know, McConnell's, you know, tax cuts or favoring the wealthy in other ways through policy and legislation.
You know, it's interesting. You write in the book about the ways in which some of these, the white nationalist right wingers, they wanted to displace a little bit the focus on free market fundamentalism. But in this conservative populist alliance, you almost see this sort of idea like, why not have both? Illustrated today by Trump's tweet just earlier today, urging for violent crackdown on protesters and what happens. And if Biden gets elected, he'll let these anarchists run free. And by the way, he'll raise taxes too. A little bit of, you know, there's a little bit there for everyone. And maybe that question, if I can tie that question to Kay's question here. And you mentioned the Senate, and since they were asking about the family, you know, I think of guys like Senators Chuck Grassley, James Langford, John Thune, these elite senators and so on, who are now doing the work of the populist, Trump's populist front. Another character Kay wonders about is Mike Pence, a Christian dominionist, and is there a plan for him to take over the presidency by the Christian right?
You know, it's funny because as much as Mike Pence has been really a heroic figure to the Christian right long before Trump came on, you know, came on the scene, right? I mean, well before that, he was just a favorite at events like the Values Voters Summit, and he's very popular among evangelicals. But I don't really see it that they're grooming him to take over for Trump, or because I think that if they thought that Pence could be as strong and powerful as Trump is to them, that they would have been okay with the impeachment because then Pence would have been president. But you didn't hear any of that. You didn't hear any, it might be okay because Pence would be president instead and he'll do all the same things for us that Trump would do. I think the thing that they admire most about Pence right now is how deferential he is to Trump.
Yeah, I think that's why I wanted to go to that question, because I think that's the answer to the family question. Pence, who's been associated with the family for a long time, Chuck Grassley and so on. The elites are now serving this white nationalist popular front. It's not so much the other way around. And in this sense, Tracy Fessenden wonders, do you believe that Trump will be successful in mobilizing this white Christian anxiety to make the current unrest a win for him, despite his deplorable handling of the pandemic and police brutality? Is Trump going to win? You believe he will? Oh, a win, I guess. All right. So Tracy's asking a win. I want to add, is he going to make it the win? What do you think?
I think that it will be a win for him from the standpoint that they won't abandon him over this, and that they'll continue to praise his strong and decisive leadership, and that he's protecting us from extremists and terrorists and anarchy in the streets. I mean, what you're seeing on the religious right now is that, you know, George Floyd's death was a great tragedy and injustice, but always the but, you know, rioting and lawlessness are a sin.
In that sense, that's sort of the way they're trying to combine stories there, that maybe that brings us to Jane Alperson's question, which I think is really goes also to the story that you tell in the book about these Christian martyr narratives, the way that they understand this blueprint. You know, you don't need to talk about a broad issue. You need to talk about one baker who just wants to make his cakes, you know? Mm-hmm. It's sort of like making it a Hallmark Channel movie. Mm-hmm. And that's interesting because that shows how this narrative is actually, it's hitting a button that is in many of our brains, regardless of our politics. Jane asks, how much of the pro-Trump Christian right has its seeds in the worship of individualism that Americans have been taught since infancy?
I really don't think it's necessarily about individualism as much as it is about the power of an individual's narrative. So, you know, you talk about the baker referring, you know, to the Supreme Court case involving Jack Phillips of Masterpiece Cake Shop in Colorado, who claimed that a civil rights complaint against him for refusing to bake a cake for a same-sex couple was a violation of his religious rights. And the Supreme Court agreed. So one of Anthony Kennedy's last acts. And I think that Phillips's case and Phillips's story is emblematic of a strategy that's been used by the right, you know, in that during that whole period that I cover in the book, where there's this kind of heroic, pious person out there in America somewhere, and these terrible ideas about, you know, civil rights and pluralism and diversity that have been imposed on high, either from Washington or by local officials who have some kind of hostility to religion, and that this individual is being persecuted by these ideas and by these government officials. And he or she, you know, needs to be, you know, protected from that. And so these individuals can be sort of their stories can be exploded into a larger narrative about the government. And again, like, this is the same sort of argument that was made about the Christian K through 12 schools and desegregation and the Bob Jones University case, that this individual, you know, is being persecuted by these government officials or by these government ideas that violate their religion. So basically, you know, we're at odds with a government that is trying to promote or expand social change.
Mm-hmm. You know, another story that's sort of part of the mythology of the religious right, and it's one that I actually appreciate your work because you're alert to it, but you never frame all the religious right, as sometimes our fellow liberal lefty critics do, as it's just about end times theology. And there's a way of sort of dismissing and distancing them as rubes or just a bunch of hicks who believe in the end of the world. They don't understand how things are. Mm-hmm. And that's not what you do in this book. Ann Joseph asks, are religious right folks all that interested in Trump as an agent of Armageddon and the rapture? Or is it just a small minority? Or is it a thing at all? It certainly is a thing, but what kind of thing is it?
I don't really think it's a thing. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, because I think that they do the comparisons that they make. Like we talked about the King Cyrus comparison, but the other comparison or description that's used a lot is that Trump is a wrecking ball. Right. And so he's this figure that's going to come and take a wrecking ball to all this, you know, political correctness that's been imposed on us and taking away our rights as Christians and taking away, you know, the way of life that we, you know, expect in Christian America. And I think that idea of him as a wrecking ball or as a disruptor, simultaneously a disruptor and a strongman, is much more prevalent and potent than any discussion of him as some figure in an end time scenario.
And the flip side of that question, and something I really appreciate and Unholy, is the ways in which, sorry, my son wants to get in the conversation. the ways in which you pay attention to the sort of intellectual roots of all this, right? Even Lance Wallnau, who was responsible for that, Cyrus. This is someone who's doing intellectual work and looking for biblical precedents and so on. So BC has a good question here. Can you comment on some of the more recent intellectual debates among the religious right-wing intellectuals? BC would like you, and I don't know if you've read this article, but maybe it gives us a jumping off point. Can you contextualize the Adrian Vermeule article, which promoted Catholic integralism and the Atlantic within the history of the intellectual strata of the Christian right? And I feel like that's a gotcha question, BC. But I
haven't read it, so no, I can't.
But I know that you can speak on the significance and importance of intellectuals within the religious right and alt-right movements that surround Donald Trump, who, whatever else we may say about him, is not an intellectual.
He is not an intellectual. And I think that there are certainly figures who try to intellectualize, white nationalism, particularly in the alt-right. There are a lot of people in the religious right who write sort of, more intellectual books. I would say that within evangelicalism, the people who write the more intellectual stuff tend to be in the not Trump camp. Someone like Russell Moore, who you brought him up and I talk about him a lot in the book. And I think that really what we're talking about with a lot of the evangelical and particularly Pentecostal and charismatic support for Trump is really more about ideology than intellectualism. And so it's really about an ideology around Trump being, like I said, like being this like sort of chaos / strongman figure who's unafraid to smash conventions in order to defend America from outsiders. And I wouldn't call that a really intellectual argument, but it is an ideological argument.
Interesting distinction. We have two, let's go with two more questions. One is a personal one, and one, it looks like, is a desperate one, but it's one that everyone's voting for, so we have to ask it. But before we get to that, this is a question that I think is important for anyone who does work like you do. Sarah, and it doesn't tell us who the questioner is, but they say, Sarah, what is it like to go to CPAC? And conservative evangelical meetings, and to that I'd add to spend time with folks like Richard Spencer. As a Jewish woman, you spend a lot of time with people who are, depending on things, more or less comfortable with the idea of your extermination and the Nazi history. What is it like? How do you do it?
It's incredibly disturbing. But as a reporter, you have to just try to work through it while you're in the room and trying to get the reporting done that you need to do to tell these stories to the world, which I think are important to tell. It's crucial that people understand what's happening and what these movements are like and about and where they get their power and their popularity. So, in the course of reporting, during Trump's rise and during his presidency, I've had a lot of very disturbing experiences. I never thought before this that I would be places where people would be, giving the Hitler salute around me or purposely speaking German or knowing that I'm Jewish and talking about, basically doing Holocaust denial in a deliberate attempt to quote unquote trigger me. I think it's important to tell these stories and to expose what is happening in this country, things that I think people of my generation thought probably were behind us. And I think a lot of people thought were behind us, but definitely are not. So, you just try to be a professional, I guess, is the answer to that.
And you try to be well informed, and I'll just tell viewers there, because we tried out this platform ahead of time, and I remember you had on your library, you had a biography. You know what you're talking about. It was a biography of Hitler. You've got to know what these people are thinking, and it was right there by your head. And I said, Sarah, I just Don't let Hitler be so close to your head. So you have to keep your distance as well. Let me combine a couple questions for this final question here. This is the most upvoted question. What if anything, I appreciate that if anything, they're aware that this is a dire situation. What if anything is the most effective way to get through to Christian friends and family who cannot or refuse to see the hypocrisy of their support for Trump? And let me add another question. And that's such a generous, kind question too. It's the hope that that this conversation is still possible. Emily Sokolov asks a variation of that in more pointed form. Is there any way to turn this train around?
So I don't know what the answer is to how do you convince family members. Everybody's different in terms of like what they would be receptive to, and everybody's different in terms of what their relationship with said family member is like. I do think that sometimes personal stories are very effective. I think that when, when marriage equality was, before the Supreme Court ruled in that case, and it seemed like it was coming down the pike, and more people were, in favor of marriage equality, I think there was a lot of polling and anecdotal stories about how if somebody knew someone in their life who was gay, they were much more willing or able to accept LGBT equality. And I don't know if that's like true across the board, and I don't know if it's true in matters of race, for example. I think there are plenty of people who know an immigrant, maybe are even friends with an immigrant, but still support Trump. So I don't know where that entry point is. It's probably different for different people. And the other question was, how do we turn this thing around? Remember, this is a country that elected Barack Obama. Donald Trump is a backlash to Barack Obama. And so it shows us that we can both move forward and have to withstand a backlash to move forward again, hopefully to move forward again. So I guess I would say do not lose hope, because it's not beyond hope. But it's also very clear that, some 40% of the country still approves of Donald Trump. And so there's no, supports his reelection. So I think that, there's kind of no room for complacency, but there's also, it's important also not to lose hope and think that the entire country needs to be turned around. But we do need to be aware that, voter suppression is real, for example, that it's not just a matter of majorities versus not majorities, but, that there's a lot of work involved in turning it around, as you say, and also in, basically, I hate this sort of frame, but like healing afterwards, that, it's going to be difficult.
Let me just ask you a follow-up on that. Tell me about, you said, I hate this frame, healing, but you use it anyways.
I couldn't think of another word.
No, but I think that goes to something so important that you learn from spending a long time looking deeply at the religious right, which is to be wary of some of the cliches with which those of us in liberalism and the left and secularism understand the world, to both understand when they're necessary, but to be wary of them, because I think sometimes when you hear the term like healing, you're like, you know what, that can smooth over and paper over a lot of ongoing trouble. Am I right in thinking that's a little bit of your discomfort with it?
Yes, exactly. Yes. Right. Because, yeah. I mean, you can't have the trauma that we've had of the Trump presidency. And it has been a trauma for the country and for a lot of individuals in the country. Not that there wasn't trauma before Trump. It's not like he invented this, but like just sort of the daily onslaught of his authoritarianism and his racism. And so like healing just sort of suggests that we can just be like, okay, let's have a kumbaya moment and everything will be better. I think it actually requires a lot more soul searching and soul digging and hard conversation for, you know, really actually to move past those, past the trauma.
Thank you so much, Sarah. This is just an amazing education from me and everyone out there. We should also say this book is really good to read too. It moves. This is it's terrifying, but it's not a book you put down. I just found myself turning the pages and saying a little bit, "Oh no, what next?" But it's a really just a masterpiece of reporting. Thank you, Sarah.
Thank you, Jeff.
Oh, and thank you both so much for this extremely important discussion and talk. And it's at a time when we definitely need to be talking about this, and it's been fantastic. I want to let everyone know, remind you that you can purchase Sarah's book, Unholy, right there at the bottom of the screen. That green button will take you directly to Politics and Prose's website. You can also, along with it, purchase Jeff's books, The Family, as well as his most recent, This Brilliant Darkness, which is fantastic. So please do that. You support both of them, support Politics and Prose. It's your patronage that enables us to bring you programming like this. And we cannot continue to host these types of events without the book sales to support them. Thank you all so much for being here. Sarah, Jeff, thank you both so much for such an amazing conversation.
Thank you, Alan.
Yeah, absolutely. I just want to say to everyone, stay safe and stay well read.